Well, again, welcome to House of Grace. We are so glad you're here. If you're a visitor today, I hope you already felt welcomed by some of our people, but we are glad that you're visiting. Thank you for all those people watching us online today. I think our stream is working today. I don't know if it is or not. We've been having internet issues for almost 2 months. How many of you love technology? And it's not because we can't fix it. It's just because, well, I won't name them by name, but some people can't do it. And it's been frustrating. And so anyways, we're glad that you're here. And again, thank you for all those who are streaming and watching us online. And it's great to have you with us today as well. So today, I just wanted to preaching a little bit again this week about a couple things. And we've been in this series, New Beginnings. Last first week, we talked about looking forward and not behind. Amen. The second week, we talked about even if, serving God no matter what the circumstances may come your way, good or bad, we're saying even if. Last week, we talked about he gave us a new beginning because he set us free, talking the power of the blood up in the cross, and talking about that we are new creations and that God loves us. Amen? Today, I want to talk about Elijah, and as we talk about new beginnings, we want to remember Elijah living in the times after David and Solomon during the rebellion of the Israelites and all those kind of things that were happening. He was living in those days and age, and how many of you know those are some crazy times? He went from the most blessed nation in those times, the richest nation in those times, to the place where they were selling and deciding they were going to eat their babies or not during the famines. You're like, man, that's just pretty rough just throwing it out there, but that's how bad it was. Sometimes we don't want to talk about that, but that's craziness. I mean, it was desperate times. Yeah. All because they chose not to follow God. Because they chose to not follow God. But his story really gets exciting during the reign of King Ahab and his crazy wife Jezebel. How many of you know crazy wife Jezebel? How many of you know a Jezebel? I mean, he's just looking around right now. Are they here today? No, I'm just joking. Not in our church. So men can be Jezebels too, by the way. Let's just be real. Literally today, I mean. Just throw it out. that's horrible. It's horrible. Some of them just got it. They're like, he tells everyone because of their rebellion from God that there will be a drought. And so this is where we're getting into it. 3 years he's been living during this drought. He's been fed by ravens, been fed by a widow, all these kind of things that happen. And it comes to the point where he starts confronting the prophets of Baal. He calls down fire from heaven. How many of you remember that story? I mean, that's a pretty awesome story. Put water on the fire, you're trying to light up. You know, that's pretty awesome. Then he not only does that, but then he kills all the prophets of Baal. That's pretty crazy, too. Hey, all 400 of you, come on over here. I've got something for you. Have you ever had somebody have something for you? Yeah, it's exciting. But then he prays for rain and it rains. It wasn't even done then. He tells Ahab, hey, get in your chariot. It's about to happen. And then he outruns Ahab's chariot. I've been known to outrun a few things, mainly moving our parked cars. That's about it nowadays. But he outran that chariot and the horses. But then we find Elijah after all those great things. Up to this point, I think Elijah's had a pretty, good life. Like I said, he's been doing things for God. He's been seeing God's hand move. I mean, he called for a drought, tried to get the people of God to repent. Saw the fire from heaven, saw the rain come, saw all these kind of things happen, man. And just so many miracles happened in Elijah's life, man. He would think in his life that everything would be good. Everything be good. But we find Elijah in chapter 19. Here we go. If you want to read in your Bible, if you can put it on your phone, it's going to be on the scripture here too. But I'm going to break this down today. We're going to get going through some scripture. I'm going to preach in the middle of it. Is that okay? It says, when Ahab got home, he told Jezebel everything that had happened. He told her, hey, look, he killed all the prophets. Those were her prophets, by the way. Told her prophets and all that kind of stuff. And she was ticked, including the way he had killed all the prophets of Baal. So Jezebel sent a message to Elijah, may the God strike me and even kill me if by this time tomorrow I have not killed you just as you killed them. She was ticked. She wanted his head. So it says, Elijah was afraid and fled for his life. He went to Beersheba, a town in Judah, and he left his servant there. I want you to hear this, Tom. He was on his way. He had a servant. Well, you know, servants back in the day, they helped him and that kind of stuff, but they were also accountability. They sort of kept him accountable for those actions and different other things. Sort of like, I have a board here at the church and friends that help keep me accountable. Tell me, hey, what are you thinking right here? What are you doing right there? But it says that he left his servant there. Why is sometimes in our greatest struggles that we want to leave the people that are supposed to help us and keep us accountable, to be our strength, to be our guides, to help us during those times? How come we want to sometimes leave those people behind? You with me? Sometimes we usually don't get to right in the middle of the stuff. And, you know, how many of you get attacked while you're sitting in church? Man, that's so rough up in this church. Usually the enemy doesn't attack me while I'm in church. Usually he attacks me when I'm all alone. Yeah, because I'm the preacher. Yeah, thanks, Bob. But when I'm sitting there and I'm going through my life and different things, when I'm at church and I'm worshiping God, it's usually not when I get attacked. It's but when I leave and I'm by myself, it's late at night. Wait, how many of you have been woken up in the middle of the night and you're sitting there going, your mind goes, blah, 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 blah. The enemy's just talking to you, and you don't have that accountability. You don't have those people around you, your support system. So what Elijah said, hey, look, I want to be alone. Why do we get alone? Why do we want to be alone sometimes? Come on now. Why do you want to be alone sometimes? So you can think. Rusty said it right. Because we want to have a pity party. How many ever had a pity party? How many of you know nobody cares when you have a pity party? They're looking at you like, what's wrong with them, man? It's weird. Nobody cares when we want to have a pity party. But we're saying, you know what? I don't want to be around nobody. I want to go and I want to. You don't know what I've been through. Nobody cares what you've been through. We do, but if you want help, then come ask for help. If you want to be alone and have a pity party, how many ever try to help somebody that's having a pity party? Just leave me alone. Okay. No problem with it. We have those times when we just, in those moments in our life, we just stop going to church regularly. We stop talking to God. We get away from all the things. Not only that, he just left his servant, but then it says, then he went on alone into the wilderness. He's like, man, I'm gonna get into this pittiness. I don't know if that's a word. Traveling all day, he sat down under a solitary broom tree and prayed that he might die. I don't know if you've ever been there before. I have in my life. I just said, hey, I just want, I don't even care. God, just take me. Take me. Take me. Take me now. Don't care if I live tomorrow. I don't care if I take another breath. I'm just done. Just done. He said, I've had enough, Lord. He said, take my life or I'm no better than my ancestors. Man, he's starting to compare me. I'm no better than these people or these people. Just kill me now, God. Take my life now. Elijah was in a place and he's getting to a place of depression, discouragement, hurt. Some of us this morning and some watching online today are in a place where you are saying, I am done. Some of you are Christians in the room and some of you are not. You're saying, I've done what you said, Lord, and nothing has changed. And you're saying, I've had enough. I've had enough. You're ready to throw in the towel and you're asking, what more can I give, God? What more are you asking of me? why should I go on? I just want to die. You're like, man, this is not, this is crazy today. I'm getting to a point. Verse 5, it says, then he lay down and slept. What do we do when we get in the pity party and we get in craziness? Man, we just want to sleep. I mean, just say, man, let's just sleep it off. Let's just keep, see what happens. You know what? Sometimes we sleep, but then the sleep becomes days of sleep and then weeks of sleep. And then it's just not physical sleep, then it's spiritual sleep. We get to the place where just like, I think, you're thinking, man, you're making fun of people, Pastor. I'm not. Listen to me. This was Elijah. This was Elijah. He just called fire down from Mount Carmel. I'm pretty sure he was close to God. I love it in the book of James. It says, but Elijah was just like a man, just like us. He had emotions just like us. Sometimes we, those men of faith in Hebrews chapter 11, man, we thinking, man, these are some superheroes of Christianity. But yet they were just men and women like us. Just men and women like us. And Elijah's having a rough day right now. Man, he's been praying. He's thinking, man, if we have this, you know, this drought, we have this. Man, all these things are going to change. The nation is going to turn. They're going to turn their ways back to God, man. And we're going to see revival in the land. And he slept. And he slept under the broom tree. But as he was sleeping, an angel touched him and told him, get up and eat. He looked around there, and beside his head were some bread, and he baked on hot stones and a jar of water. So he got up and drank. Then he lay down again. The angel was saying, hey, here's some stuff to eat. Here's some stuff that I want to give you. I mean, the angel was giving it to him. But the first time he ate, and he said, I'm just going to eat enough just to get by. I'm just going to eat just enough to get by. I'm going to do what I need to do just to get by. Then the angel of the Lord came again and touched him and said, get up and eat some more. On the journey ahead will be too much for you. So it says in verse 8, he says, so he got up and ate and drank, and the Lord gave him enough strength to travel 40 days and 40 nights to Mount Sinai. I'll be honest with you, I wish the Lord would give me some of those meals for my family, that I could eat once and my whole family would be fed for 40 days a night. I mean, that would be amazing. Can you imagine your grocery bill? One time you eat once and then just poof. It'd be amazing. But God gave him enough energy and food, supernatural energy and food, that he lasted 40 days and nights on that one meal. It didn't say that he was feeble after. He said, make him strength for 40 days and nights. Are you listening to me? Now listen to me. After he got that food that God had given him, then, what does it say? He says, then he went to Mount Sinai, but found a cave. God gave him that strength, and he gave him that courage, gave him that meal. But then the first place that Elijah went, he went to a cave because he said, I'm not done having my pity party. He could have went and done anything he wanted at that moment. He could have went and accomplished what God had asked him to accomplish with that meal, but he didn't. He used it to go to a cave. You with me? So he went to a cave where he spent the night and had enough for 40 days and nights, but he used it in the direction God didn't ask him to go. He didn't tell him, hey, why don't you go? I'm going to give you this so you can. God was giving it to him so he could get up, go forward. But he went, and he went in a place that God didn't ask him to go. And he found himself in a cave. You ever noticed what a cave's like? Have you ever been in a cave? Have you ever thought about the first guy that ever went to those Carlsbad Caverns? Man, I've thought about that a lot. Man, home, man, I mean, that dude was crazy. There's no way I'm like, I'm going to go. This is a bottomless pit, pretty much. I'm going to go down there. Not with the flashlight, with the candle. I'm gonna go in there with the candle. Not me. especially a bottomless pit, which I always like the sign that says bottomless pit, and then it gives you the, you ever seen those signs? The bottomless pit, then it gives you how deep it is. Stupid, huh? It's not bottomless of it. Sorry. But it's dark in a cave. You can't see what's in front of you. It's lonely in a cave. I've been in a couple of those places where I didn't know where I was at. Man, I felt isolated. But we get in those caves, then we start talking to ourselves, or a spiritual cave. We start saying, man, nobody knows or understands my situation. Nobody knows what I'm going through. No one is with me. No one is helping me. It's quiet in our cave. How many of you ever been in a dark place where your thoughts get the best of you because all you can think about is the enemy's talking to you and whispering to you? And it seems like even when we're in the Bible, man, we're distracted. We can't get nothing out of it. Exactly where the enemy wants us. Exactly where the enemy wants us. I like what this next verse, let's go back to our scripture. It says, but the Lord said to him, this is the title of my message today, what are you doing here, Elijah? What are you doing here, Elijah? Just now saw all these kind of great things happening. He saw all these miracles. And God finds Elijah in a cave, and he says, what are you doing here, Elijah? Why are you in this dark and dreary cave? Are you just going to keep going from place to place until you die? You're going to keep moving around until you just, no one knows where you're at, and you don't think I know where you're at. Are you just going to live here until you die? Let's go back to the verses. Verse 10, Elijah replied, man, he's saying, he's putting this out here. This is what we do with God too. He said, man, I have zealously served the Lord God Almighty, but the people of Israel, I love how he says, the people of Israel, hey, it's your people. I love all this. This is, I mean, me and wife do this all the time when our kids do something stupid. Man, that's your kid. That's your kid. That ain't my kid. He's saying, the people of Israel, man, those crazy people over there, man, they're not serving you. They have broken your covenant with you. They torn down your altars and killed every one of your prophets. And then he says, I'm the only one left. I'm the only one that cares. I'm the only one that's seeking you. I'm the only one that's trying to do the right thing. Look at the rest of the world, God. Look at all these people. Even in my church, there's nobody living like I'm living. Everybody just sinning, man. Look at them. You're picking apart their lives because you want to feel better about your situation. You with me? Verse 11, it says, go out and stand before me on the mountain. And the Lord told him, as Elijah stood there, the Lord passed by, and a mighty windstorm hit the mountain. It was such a terrible blast that the rocks were torn loose. I mean, that's pretty crazy. But the Lord was not in the wind. And the wind was there, there was an earthquake. But the Lord was not in the earthquake. I mean, no, that would be crazy. And after the earthquake, there was a fire. But the Lord was not in the fire. I always think about these three things. I mean, if I saw the earthquake, I was like, man, God's got to be in that because he'd already seen God and call down fire from heaven. He's already seen all these miraculous things. You think, man, God's in that earthquake, and God's in that fire, and God's in that wind that's happening. Because he had seen the power of God. He had seen the power of God. He knew what the power of God looked like, and he was trying to recognize that. Man, that's God. But he recognized he didn't feel his presence in any three of those things. I want you to listen again what God says here. And there was a gentle sound of a whisper. And when Elijah heard it, he wrapped his face in his cloak because he started feeling God's presence again. It's very, very important right there. Because sometimes we want God to do the amazing, and God's saying, I know what you really need. I want you to hear what the whisper was. He went out and stood at the entrance of the cave, and a voice of God said, "What are you doing here, Elijah? What are you doing here, Elijah?" See, some of you are in horrible situations, or you're discouraged because you've been asking God to do this, you've been asking God to do this, you've been asking God to do something in your family, do something in your marriage, do something with your life. And you're finding yourself in a spiritual cave this morning, and you just sat down, and you said, "I don't even care if I die. I don't see you moving, God. I don't see your hand. I mean, I've been praying, I've been fasting, I've been giving, I've been doing all these things for you for so long, God. For so long, I've served you with all my heart and all my life." And God's saying to you this morning, said, "What are you doing here? What are you doing here? Why are you here? Are you here just to die? Are you here just to live out your days and not move forward? Are you here just to give in and let the enemy run rampant over your mind, over your feelings, over your emotions? What are you doing here? What are you doing here?" He's saying, "Why do you keep trying to run from me? Keep trying to run to the things you think I'm in." He's saying, "Quit trying to run to the things that others say are amazing." He was saying, "You've lost sight of who you are and who I am." It was God showing Elijah in that one moment where he didn't feel like he could go on anymore, is that Father's love, that intimacy where he draws close to Elijah and saying, "Why are you here? I've come to give you life and life more abundantly. And why are you here to die?" Then Elijah, I'm sure it wasn't the same, but he says, I can almost see Elijah's heart breaking at this very moment. He said, "God, I've been zealous. And I've served you for all my life. Israel's going against you. They've broken their covenant. They've done all these kind of things." And he said, "I don't know what else to do. I don't know what else to do, Father." This is what the Lord says. Then the Lord said and told him, says, "Go back the same way you came." He said, "Go back to what I've asked you to do. Go back to and live again. Shake yourself from this death mindset. I didn't ask you to go here. I've asked you to live. I've asked you to serve me even in these moments, even in these things. I'm asking you that you would draw close to me, because I don't know if you've heard it before, but it's hard to hear a whisper unless you're close. In those moments when we want to die and we don't feel like God's answering, we don't feel like our spirit's broken, our spirit's just dry and thirsty. It's those moments that we don't need the earthquake. We don't need the fire. We don't need the wind. What we need is the still small voice of the Father whispering, saying, I am here. I am here. I haven't left you. I know where you're at right now. I know you're hurting. I know all these things." What we need in those moments is that intimacy. We need to draw closer to the Father. We need to draw closer to the Father than we ever have in our lives. Why are you here? We need to reconnect to his intimacy, hear his voice. We need to hear his encouragement. We need to hear the Father whispering these things to us, saying, I love what it says. And then he says, to travel to the wilderness, to Damascus. When you arrive there, anoint Hazael to be king of Aram. Then anoint Jehu, grandson of Nimshi, to be king of Israel. And anoint Elisha, son of that whatever that name is, from the town of whatever that name is to replace you as my prophet. What he was saying is, he's saying, I have greater things in the latter part of your life. I know you've been through it. I know this kind of things, but I have greater plans for you in the latter part of your life than he did greater things. If you look at Elijah's life, he did awesome things after this moment, but God's saying, why are you here? What are you going to do here? Are you just going to stay here and die? What is that going to do for you? You have to get up. You have to get up. You still have people who live that need, that you need to touch and change. You have kids, you have people, you have a spouse, you have people, you have a purpose and you have a plan, and you have a destiny, but you got to get up. You've got to get up. He goes on and says all the things that he wants Elijah to do. In 2 Timothy 1:9, it says, and it's talking, Paul's talking to Timothy here, it says, who saved us and called us to a holy calling. Not because of our works, but because of his own purpose and grace, which he gave us in Christ Jesus before the ages began. Every one of us has been given a calling, a purpose, something that God wants us to do. And I know that some of you have been in horrible situations. You've been in some horrific things that have happened. But God's asking you today, why are you here? God has something more for you than what the situation you are in right now. Paul states that we have been saved and called with a holy calling. If you have been saved, you have been called. God created you with a purpose and an intention. If he saved you, he did it on purpose, not by accident. God has saved your life to be a divinely woven tapestry of his purpose and his plan. You only see in your side, but you don't see what all he has in store for you. But there is an alternative purpose at play. According to Jesus, the devil comes again to steal, kill, and destroy. And if he can't destroy us, he at least wants to make us ineffective. He wants us to sit down. He wants to find us in a cave. He wants to have that power and authority over us in those moments. Sometimes we find ourselves in a cave where we question who we are and our identity and our purpose. Some of us are struggling right now. You want more than anything to have a new beginning. I need to get up. Some of you already, the Holy Spirit's already talking to you. I need you to get up. Why are you here? Why are you here right now? Why are you in this part of your life? Why are you sitting still when I have a life for you to live? You prayed and some things didn't happen. I'm there. I mean, to be honest with you, I don't know if this message is for you or if it's more for me, because I've been praying for some things to happen. I just haven't seen them yet. You don't think pastor gets discouraged? You don't think pastor finds himself in a cave sometimes? You don't think the devil doesn't whisper in my ears? It's never going to happen. Why do you keep trying? Even this last Tuesday, we had prayer this last Tuesday, and I found myself just going through the motions of prayer. And I mean, if you were there in that prayer meeting, I asked God to forgive me right then. It's because I was just going through the motions. I was like, God, forgive me. There's life in here. Why am I sitting and depressed about things I have not seen yet? I had to shake myself. I had to wake myself up a little bit. Because in the same way with us, we sit down and we're thinking, God, I prayed. I've done everything I know to do. If we stay in those moments, we'll never see the miracle. We'll never see what God has for us. Some of you are saying, well, I've given into offerings. I give to the poor. Some of you are like, what else? I've given my whole life to you. I lived for you since I was a kid. And what has that done for me? Some of you have checked out mentally and emotionally. Some of you, because of discouragement, some of you because of some other things, you've even returned to parts of your life that were sinful. Because it brings comfort. You're managing your life. You're not living it. I'm going to say that again because I need that to sink in. Some of you are managing your life but not living. If you're managing your life, you know exactly what I'm talking about. You're going through everything you need to do. You're checking off the boxes every day. And as long as you get those things done, you're okay. And God said, that's not what I called you to do. I've called you for so much more. disciples went through this as well as after they buried Jesus. What did they do? They went back fishing. God, hey, we had a lot of things planned. You went to heaven. I know what to do here. Peter was in a depression. He thought he'd let Christ down. He thought everything that he'd lived for those last 3 years. Peter was married too. I don't even know where his wife was in those 3 years. That would have been weird to say, hey, babe, I got to follow Jesus. I mean, I guess if you're going to follow Jesus, I guess that works. It's Jesus. Another whole story. But Jesus, when he comes to that, as Micah comes. But when Jesus, when he went to that beach and they found him, and it says Jesus was cooking some fish on the fire. It said, they come up to the beach. It says Peter threw on his garments and just ran to the beach. And Jesus asked him three times. He said, hey, do you love me? And Peter's like, man, you know I love you. Jesus, Jesus didn't wrap his arms around him and comfort him at that moment. He said, if you love me, you know I love him. I mean, Peter knew that Jesus loved him. He said, I want you to feed my sheep. And he goes through this three times, and Peter, I mean, you can tell the third time, Peter's really upset. He's like, man, you know I love you. Jesus was really asking Peter, said, what are you doing here? What are you doing here? For 3 years, I poured out my life and told you we have a kingdom to reach. And you're fishing. What are you doing here? Did you come here to fish and just die? Some of you, like I said, if you've gone through something right now, and it may not be your whole life, but some areas of your life, you're just thinking, Jesus said, what are you doing here in this area? Have you forgot that, man, I can heal and I can restore that area of your life too? Some of you are just going through the motions of your life right now. You're just managing your life. You're in the cave, but you know you got to go to work. You got to do that kind of stuff. But your relationship with Christ is far off. Because you've been discouraged. Something's happened. Something's gotten in the way of the intimacy that you've had with the Father. You stopped seeing his hand move as much as it was, and you don't know what's happened. I'm just saying it's not the time to run and find a place to sit down. It's the time to get up and say, Father, Lord, I need you more than I ever have in my life. Elijah had done all those things, but he had lost the intimacy of getting close to the Father and saying, Father, in this moment, I feel lost. In this moment, I have nothing else to give. In this moment, I've done everything I feel like I can do, and I don't see a lot happening. And at that moment, his presence overtook him. And he knew he could get up and move. He knew he could get up and go on. Where are you at in your life? I ask you the same question. What are you doing here? What are you doing here? Are you living? Are you stagnant? Are you just sitting down? Do you find yourself most days in a cave? You just find yourself sleeping and trying to find ways to escape. Are you going to live your life that way for the rest of your life? Will you bow your heads today? If you're in that situation, every head bowed and every eye closed, but you're in that situation right now. God's asking you this morning, said, what are you doing here? I'm here to help you. I'm here to reconnect with you. I'm here to allow you to feel my presence in such a real and a powerful way. I'm here to allow the oil just begin to pour over you and heal those areas of your life. I'm here right now. I know you're hurting. I know you've been hurt. But I'm here for you right now. If that's you, I want you to start just moving towards the front. I'm going to pray for you. Don't worry what anybody else thinks. You know if that's you or not. You know if you're in the cave, and we've all been in the cave. I talked to you about it. But if that's you, I want you to start moving. Come on, come forward. I want to pray with you today. Say, look, I'm discouraged. I don't care if you feel like you're the most holiest person in the room today. I don't care. I'm just saying, if you feel that way, come. Let the Holy Spirit do something this morning. Come on. Who else? Just lift your hands this morning. Just lift your hands. Anybody else today? I know there's more of you out here. Come on. Lord, say, I need you to re-engage. There's people counting on you. There's people counting on you. You got a family that's counting on you. You have people that are looking up to you even right now. What you gonna do? What you gonna do? I want those that are just here, I want you to just begin to raise your hands. Holy Spirit's gonna start ministering right now. I need some prayer workers to come as well. If it's you, come on. There's more people here than this. I know the Holy Spirit's been dealing with me this message all week. You're just in a spot. You just need to say, God, I need your help. I need your help. I'm discouraged. I'm let down. I got some things going on. Come on. I'll wait just a moment longer. Don't miss your opportunity for the Holy Spirit to minister to you right now. Come on, just surrender. Just let go today. Don't worry about what anybody else is doing, what anybody else is saying. Come on. Anybody else in the room today? Come on. I need some more prayer workers, by the way, guys. Come on. Begin to start crying out to him, guys. God sees you. He sees what you put in. He sees what you're hurting in. He sees all those things that are dealing with you right now. Father, Lord, I ask. Come on, I'll wait just a moment longer. I feel like there's just a couple more people. He's saying, come on, re-engage. Come on, re-engage. Come on, re-engage. You feel this presence even right where you're staying. Just take a step today. Some of you today, you need to re-engage with some people in your life. You've left your servant behind. You left your support behind. You left those people behind. And you need to make a fresh commitment, even right now in your heart. You may be sitting down, you may be standing up saying, Father, Lord, I need that accountability again. I need to reach out again so I can have people that are there to speak truth and life, to speak scripture over me, to pray over me, to Lord, hold me, help draw me closer to you, Father. Some of you need to make that commitment today. Say, I need to start going to church more regularly. I need to start grabbing, even going to some Bible studies. I need to go to the ladies or the men's or whatever that may be. I need some help in that area. I feel so lonely. And the Holy Spirit's saying, you need to re-engage in that area as well. Lord, I pray for those who came forward. I pray for those who didn't. Lord, I pray, Father, Lord, as we read about Elijah, the man of God, somebody who has done things for us, but we all find ourselves in those moments that we're struggling. Lord, and I'm asking, Lord, as we're struggling, that we just remember the title of this message, it just sparked this message, not because I preach it, because it's your word. It says, what are you doing here? And at that moment, Father, what I'm asking, that we would find you. Help us. Help all of us, Father. Help all of us, Father, Lord, to run to you in those moments. We need your presence to help us, Father, Lord, because we can't do it by ourselves. We need your strength and courage and life. We need you to breathe life into us again. We ask you to be with these that are up here and those who are discouraged, even at their house, those who are going through something. Maybe they can't even get here. Maybe they can't even get to church and they feel isolated at their house. Father, would I pray for them? Lord, I'm asking, Lord, that they would hear that same voice that Elijah heard. You're the same yesterday, today, and forever. Let that same voice begin to speak, Lord, in those homes. Right where they're at. Let them, your presence begin to engulf that living room or bedroom or wherever they may be today. You have not forgotten us. You never have. You said you would never leave us nor forsake us. Help us remember those things. In your name I pray today, Jesus. Amen. Amen.
Amen, amen, y'all. Woo! Did God talk to you today? Ooh, he's talking to me. Yes, what a great service. You can watch the service again on Facebook or on our YouTube page, or if you want to share it with somebody, make sure to do that. If it's your first time here today, make sure to fill out the Connect card that's in front of you in those chairs, or we have some back in the Connect booth or in the merch shop. And if God did something really special, especially, fill that card out and let us know. And if you want to be baptized, let us know. That's coming up soon, okay? Next week, okay? And don't forget the kids, ages 8 through 12, summer camp Q&A meeting right here in the cave, right after service. And to get signed up for the missions trip, you can talk to Pastor Dylan about that. And ladies, we have our first dinner out this Friday night, and we have a conference coming up. So if you have any questions about that, I'll be right back here at the Connect booth. Y'all have a wonderful, blessed week.